like a woman on top is easier. Mm-hmm. You know, rubbing in certain areas is easier than other positions. And what was your question? A good magazine is, and when we do really great issues of Cosmo, it's like a voyage of discovery mm-hmm. that you didn't know you were on, that you turn the page and you have no idea what's coming next. And my only sort of reservation about social media is that when you're selecting who you're following, you're self-selecting and you're closing off the world sometimes. And what I love about magazines or newspapers or the physical act of turning the page mm-hmm. and not knowing what's coming is that that's exciting.
I wonder if there's a way to combat the closed-offedness or, you know, the very streamlined vertical of knowing exactly who you're following and being able to personalize to such a thorough extent.
You know, I mean, there's a great phrase about how do you escape your world. You can't escape your world by talking to your best friends. If you're stuck and you want to find a door opening somewhere else, you can't do it by reinforcing what you're interested in.
Right. At what point did you switch into fashion?
Well, my first experience with fashion actually was when I was at the Times of London. Mm-hmm. I was their bureau chief in New York. The fashion editor couldn't cover the shows because they fell on Yom Kippur. So I was asked to cover them, and I was like, oh, really? Do I have to do this? And then I was absolutely mesmerized. It was so interesting. I was like, all systems go. I want to go to every single show I can. I want to meet every designer I can. This is so much fun.
What was it that intrigued you?
I love the mix of creativity and commerce. I love talking to designers about how they think about women's lives. Like, no one is more interesting to talk to about what it's like being a modern woman, oddly, than Albert Arbaz.
What do you feel like has been the most rewarding part of your job at Cosmo?
Opening the door a little bit wider and having Cosmo Careers in there has been really successful. It's super fun and interesting to do. We just did our first Fun Fearless Life conference, which was all about inspiring young women to become the leaders of tomorrow. And these are new leaders who aren't leading in traditional classic ways. They've forged new territory.
Right.
And I think introducing that to this already extremely rich brand of Cosmo is really fun.
How many men are staffed at Cosmo?
Well, there are about 6 or 7, and then as many models, male models obviously, preferably topless, that we can find.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we just pull them in.
Bring them out.
Yeah. That's what it's like. The office is like Magic Mike.
Makes me feel like women are commodifying men the same way that men commodified.
Yeah. So I don't know if it's progress. It's like the joke is on all of us. We're not exclusively hetero. We do cover all aspects of sexuality. It's important. And I think people are more open about sexuality now. They're more able to be, partly because of the web. And so we talk a lot about that too.
What do you believe makes the appropriate sex story for Cosmo?
Well, what we try and do is a combination of sex stories in Cosmo. We want to have fun, and every now and then it might just teeter on the edge. But we want to have fun, and that's what those things are, right? We weigh in with something when we feel it's important. So I'm really proud of discussions that we're having in Cosmo. Why aren't there more female leaders in the workplace, in politics? Why is this still so difficult to make happen?
Do you see any sort of solution?
It seems to me very straightforward. Women should have equal opportunities to men. They should be paid equally for equal work. You know, and men don't want their daughters to earn less than their sons. And women obviously don't want to earn less than men. It's very odd to me.
Yeah, that's funny because my dad is obviously from a traditional Turkish background, and so I don't think he ever expected that I would build my own company. And his joke now is, I have 4 children, 3 of them are boys, but only my girl has balls. Which I very much
that
like.
That is fantastic. That is a great line. That is a great line.
Okay, so to wrap this up, let's get 3 of the most paramount slices of advice that you could give to budding CEOs.
Always give both names. This is a big difference between men and women. When men meet you, they go, hello, John Smith. When women meet you, they go, hi, I'm Tamara. And I understand the informality and trying to put someone at ease by not using your last name, but I think it's super important young women use their last names.
Hi, I'm Leandra Medine. How are you? It's lovely to meet you.
There you go. The only person I would say is an exception to this, and she already is CEO of her own life, is Madonna.
I was...
Right. Don't assume that your best friends or your family will help you get to the next level. It's often someone that you don't even think is significant in your life who can expand your horizons. And people often don't realize that. People get locked into their world and locked into the people they know, and they can't see beyond it. Just be open to every opportunity, and be open to opportunities you didn't think you would be interested in.
Right.
Learn to negotiate. If you feel uncomfortable doing it, because it's a really hard thing to do, use we instead of I. And always talk about it if you want more money or a promotion in terms of what you can do together.
Have you ever given this advice and seen one of your employees practice it on you?
Yes, very good question. They do it all the time. And when I'm giving this advice, I always say, not you, don't do it to me.